problem with volcanoes is that they're unpredictable and very destructive, especially when they spend decades or even centuries doing nothing but gathering magma in a massive magma chamber. The difference between other volcanoes and Yellowstone is that Yellowstone does this on an industrial scale compared to your average volcano. The magma chamber there has a capacity of around 25,000 cubic kilometers, which is about 1,000 times larger than your typical volcano. This chamber fills with melt as time progresses. Eventually, the pressure inside the magma chamber becomes so large that the rocks above it can't hold it back any longer, and the magma begins to fracture the rock above it and force its way to the surface. Fortunately for us, the increase in pressure and fracturing of rock produces lots of ground swelling and deformation, and also makes quite the seismic din and racket, which we can detect on seismographs around the park. Unfortunately, the magma chamber at Yellowstone is massive and doesn't know when to sit still and behave itself because of all the magma movement going on in there. That means that we get lots of ground movement and earthquakes. This can make it jolly confusing for all of us, but luckily, there is one type of seismic reading which is tremendously useful, the harmonic tremor. Essentially, it is a long-form seismic signal caused by magma moving and breaking rock as it goes. It's not full. Sometimes harmonic signals can start without any eruptions at all, and that's a trick Yellowstone could pull off as magma moves around the system. If you see a strong harmonic tremor after an increased amount of ground swelling and earthquakes, that's a reasonable indication something is on the way. Even then though, you still don't know what. In the near future, the Yellowstone hotspot is projected to have small events affecting only its immediate location. These would include lava flows, steam explosions, increased gas emissions, and a single vent comparatively small volcanoes. In that case, nothing would happen to the United States except for the closure of part or all of the first national parks. But I recognize there is a greater popular concern of a potential super eruption, or one of category VEI-8, also known as the Volcano Eruption Index. The magma chambers beneath Yellowstone are currently not in a state where they can erupt catastrophically. It is calculated that decades of magmatic earthquakes, crustal deformation, and increased hydrothermal activity, much more than what you've heard of recently, would indicate a return to volatility of the magma below. But if things begin to change down there, if fresh magma is injected from below so that, say, 20 years from now, it could erupt explosively, that is time in which the nation and its people can prepare for the unthinkable. The next eruption of Yellowstone's hotspot is expected to be small. Steam explosions, a lava flow, gas emissions, or a single vent volcano or two, as 80 out of the past 81 eruptions have been effusive rather than explosive. Such would only affect the local area and not impact either of the neighbors north and south of the USA. These eruptions don't really come without warning signs. The safety board will certainly learn from the Mount St. Helens disaster in 1980 and close the park off to the public and evacuate nearby cities in this scenario. It might cause flash floods. It might cause some ash fall in Wyoming, Idaho, or Montana. It might create a loud bang as well. It would cause millions, probably billions of dollars of damage due to some ash fall around the volcano, but nothing really bad would happen. However, most people are mistakenly certain that any volcanism from Yellowstone must of necessity be a VEI-8 event. Okay, let's go there. The chance of Yellowstone going full supervolcano is very low. But if Yellowstone threatened to go supervolcano, we would notice, because the earthquakes around the volcano would be more intense. There's an interesting movie about this called Supervolcano, which sort of tackles the question of what would be the fallout of an explosion. It was a disaster movie, and it's had its share of embellishments, but I think it was relatively accurate of a portrayal of what might happen if a supervolcanic eruption occurred. Some basic points. It would cover the U.S. grain belt in volcanic ash, collapse building roofs, and take out the power grid as volcanic ash is conductive. We'd likely face mass starvation as it killed crops globally. Ash is also basically tiny razor-sharp particles, so breathing it in would shred your lungs, and the sheer volume of it would, as others have said, make large parts of North America uninhabitable for some time. The ash would cause the most problems. Farms are devastated, houses are damaged, humans are killed, and thousands of millions of people would be at risk of respiratory problems. Salt Lake City and Denver would be at risk of massive ashfall. The continental United States would experience some ashfall. Even the East Coast would have some ashfall. It is said that Mount St. Helens, a volcano that barely crossed in the VEI-5 territory, had 540 million tons of ash, which is around 1 cubic kilometer. So imagine Mount St. Helens, but 2,450 times over. Most graphics and data have been concentrated on the United States. Canada and Mexico are far enough from ground zero so that, as one answer says, most of Canada will receive 1 to 3 millimeters of ash. Now people say that it doesn't sound like much. It isn't. A good number of people got almost 1 millimeter from Mount St. Helens in 1980. A large caldera-forming eruption is projected to last about 1 week at least, though the projections predict several weeks of debilitating ashfall, maybe stretching out to a month. So, ash spread thick around these regions will render them inhospitable. Definitely, aircraft will be grounded, water contaminated, power and communications disrupted, and the Rocky Mountain region and the Great Plains of the U.S. will be devastated. But most of Canada and Mexico will not do badly, initially. However, climate change from stratospheric sulfur dioxides and other particles reflecting sunlight back to space may chill the planet, 5 to 10 Celsius for several years. This is an aerosol, which is why it can stay aloof that long, not to be confused with most of the ash which would fall. Less severe chilling could last for a century. So, essentially, it would hit the brakes on global warming, at least for the time being. But then comes rebuilding. Even though hampered by volcanic winter, it won't be the end of the world. Refugees from the frozen north, from Alaska and Canada, will seek haven in the south, even as the northern Europeans and Asians will. Food and medicine, beyond stockpiles, will have to be purchased or received from climatologically largely unaffected southern hemisphere nations. The good news is that such a large eruption cannot just happen without years of warning, probably decades. This is because the magma chambers beneath the park are too cool and too solid for large-scale volcanism without tons of years of easy detectable changes. During that time, humankind can prepare. Thus, billions need not die, not even from starvation. Millions need not die. The Yellowstone threat has been exaggerated beyond what can be supported by observatory science. The last Yellowstone supervolcano eruption was around 630,000 years ago. Most volcanologists feel that another such event is at least several generations away. The present magma chamber is still mostly solid, and no precursor events, such as profound ground-level changes, tens of feet, changes in gas emissions, and changes in groundwater chemistry or temperature have been detected. The entire caldera area, the size of Rhode Island, is continuously monitored by a lot of really, really competent scientists. But volcanoes don't erupt on egg timers. They erupt pretty randomly when the conditions are right. In particular, the Yellowstone system is dynamic and constantly changing. We can't second guess it because so often it does things utterly randomly. It is also one of the largest volcanic systems in the world, with a volume of 25,000 kilometers, and honestly, it wouldn't surprise anyone if the eruption happened right now, or a million years from now. So long as the system remains active, this possibility will always exist. But unlikely that anything of that sort will come about without some warning signs. So, until otherwise specified by government agencies, we really have nothing to worry about. So there you are, guys. I hope this video offers some good insight. If you enjoyed it, please be sure to hit the like button and subscribe for more content like this. And as always, thanks for watching.